Well, students, in the previous lecture, we talked about characteristic X-rays which were produced when fast-moving electrons strike the target atom and knock out an electron from the innermost shell, either the K-shell or the L-shell. And the X-rays given out during the transition from the upper level to the lower vacant level, those X-rays were called as characteristic X-rays. So, in this process, the electrons, fast-moving electrons, lose kinetic energy to the electron in the innermost shell and knock it off. And that's how the X-rays are produced. The second type of X-rays are produced by a different process. The electrons, this fast-moving electrons, lose the kinetic energy by a different process. And that gives rise to the second type of X-rays called as continuous X-rays. So what happens here? The electron coming from the filament, fast-moving electrons coming from the filament, these electrons, they penetrate deep inside the target atom, but they do not strike any of the orbiting electrons of this target atom. So this electron passes right through the atom without colliding with any of the orbital electrons. But as it passes through the interior parts of the atom, it comes under the influence of the nucleus, positively charged nucleus. Okay, so it comes under the influence of the nuclear forces, because of which the path of the electrons, the path of this electron changes. It was traveling in this direction, so the nucleus attracts it towards itself and its path changes, and also the electron is slowed down. So because of the attractive force of the nucleus, the electron coming from the filament, as it penetrates deep inside the atom, the electron is slowed down. So slowing down of the electron means its velocity becomes less, means its kinetic energy also becomes less. So the electron loses kinetic energy continuously in this process. So it doesn't lose kinetic energy in just one shot by colliding with an electron, but the electron loses kinetic energy constantly as long as it is under the influence of the nuclear forces of the nucleus of this target atom. Okay, so as the electron is constantly being slowed down, it loses kinetic energy, and this loss of kinetic energy is continuously given out as X-ray photons, continuous X-rays. So that's why these X-rays are called as continuous X-rays, because they are continuously being given out and their wavelength is continuous. Unlike characteristic X-rays, where the wavelength, the X-rays were made up of discrete wavelengths, fixed wavelengths, K alpha, K beta, K gamma. So there are discrete lines here. Here in continuous X-ray spectra, the X-rays which are given out are not having fixed wavelengths, but they consist of wavelengths having continuous values. So right from a minimum value to a large value, the X-rays which are given out have all possible wavelengths, all continuous wavelengths. Okay, so remember, what is the process occurring here? The fast moving electron, how does it lose kinetic energy? It loses kinetic energy because of the influence of the nucleus, nuclear forces. So the nucleus slows down the electron and also changes its paths, and as the electron is slowed down, it loses kinetic energy, and the loss of kinetic energy is given out continuously as X-rays, continuous X-rays having continuous wavelengths. Now, important thing about continuous X-rays is that the wavelength of X-rays which is given out depends on the accelerating voltage. If the accelerating voltage was higher, meaning that these electrons which were coming from the filament were having higher speed, then the X-rays which are given out also will have higher wavelength. So the wavelength of the X-rays depends on what was the speed or what was the voltage applied to these, accelerating voltage applied to these electrons. It does not depend on the target element. Whatever may be the target, the wavelength of the X-rays which are given out, continuous X-rays which are given out, depends only on the voltage which was applied to this, accelerating voltage which was applied to these electrons. Okay, so this is the difference between characteristic and continuous X-ray spectra. In characteristic X-ray spectra, the X-rays are given out in form of discrete wavelengths, discrete lines. Continuous X-rays, the X-rays are given out having continuous wavelengths. Second difference is that in characteristic X-rays, the X-rays wavelength depend on the target atom and not on the accelerating voltage applied to the electrons here. Whereas in continuous X-rays, the wavelength of X-rays which are given out depends on the voltage applied. It depends on the speed of these electrons, meaning it depends on the accelerating voltage applied to these electrons. And it doesn't depend on the target atom. Whatever may be the target, whether copper, molybdenum or tungsten, it doesn't depend, the wavelength of the X-rays given out doesn't depend on the target atom. So these are some important differences between characteristic and continuous X-ray spectra. Now, Continuous X-ray spectra, as I told you, it consists of all possible wavelengths, starting from a minimum wavelength. So, starting from a minimum wavelength called as lambda minimum, also called as cutoff wavelength. Above this, all wavelengths are there. Continuous wavelengths are there. All wavelengths are there. But below lambda minimum, no wavelengths are there. So, there is something called as cutoff wavelength or lambda minimum, which we are going to derive a formula for it. Okay. So, expression for cutoff wavelength. So, what is cutoff wavelength? Remember, in continuous X-rays, the X-rays start from lambda minimum. The wavelength of X-rays start from lambda minimum, and above lambda minimum, all X-rays are there. Below lambda minimum, there are no X-rays. So, lambda minimum is called the cutoff wavelength. So, how do we derive a formula for it? Now, if you see in this figure, the electron which enters the atom, target atom, it enters it with a velocity v, and then it is slowed down. Its direction also changes, and it comes out in this direction with a velocity v dash. Now, since the electron is slowed down, this velocity with which it comes out, v dash, will be less than the velocity with which it had entered the atom. So, v dash is less than v. Now, how much kinetic energy is lost by the electrons? Therefore, if the outgoing velocity is v and the incoming velocity is v dash and the incoming velocity was v, how much the energy lost by the kinetic energy lost by the electron? Kinetic energy of the incoming electron is half mv square. And kinetic energy of the outgoing electron is half mv dash square. So, the loss of kinetic energy is the difference between the two. Now, this loss of kinetic energy, what happens to it? It's given out in the form of X-rays. The loss of kinetic energy is given out in the form of X-rays. Now, X-rays, what is the energy of X-ray? X-ray photon, one photon has an energy h nu, right? So, if the X-rays which are given out have a frequency nu, then we can write loss of kinetic energy, half mv square minus half mv dash square, must be equal to h nu. What is this h nu? H nu is the energy of the X-ray photon. So, this is the equation which basically is the law of conservation of energy. What it says is that energy lost by the electron, kinetic energy lost by the electron, is converted and given out in the form of a X-ray photon h nu. So, h nu must be equal to half mv square minus half mv dash square. So, please, what is the meaning of this equation? Loss of kinetic energy of the electron is converted and given out in the form of a X-ray photon having energy h nu. Now, when will this h nu be maximum? As per this equation, when will this be maximum? Now, since this is a difference of two terms, half mv square and half mv dash square, if this term is not there, if the subtracting term is not there, then h nu will be maximum. So, h nu will become maximum when this part is zero. Now, if this part is zero means outgoing kinetic energy is zero means, basically what it means is that v dash is zero. So, it means that if this electron as it is going out completely is brought to rest, it is fully brought to rest. So, it is slowed down and finally brought to rest, meaning v dash is equal to zero. In that case, the energy of the photon, X-ray photons given out will be, h nu will be maximum, because then there will be no subtracting term over there. So, what will be the maximum energy? Therefore, h nu max will be just half mv square without this term. Subtracting term is not there. Why? Because the v dash is zero. So, h nu max is half mv square. So, now, we want an expression for wavelength, whereas here we have a equation in terms of frequency. So, frequency can be converted in terms of wavelength by the formula nu is equal to c by lambda. Frequency is velocity of light upon wavelength. So, we replace nu by c by lambda. But remember, since frequency and wavelength are inversely proportional to each other, when frequency is maximum, wavelength becomes minimum. So, what we have done here is, we will replace nu by c by lambda. We have replaced nu with c by lambda. But lambda minimum. Why? Because here it is frequency maximum, wavelength becomes minimum as frequency and wavelength are inversely proportional to each other. So hc upon lambda minimum is equal to half mv square. This part remains the same. Now, this part, half mv square kinetic energy, is difficult to measure because you cannot measure the velocity of the electron. It's very difficult to, electrons are moving very fast. The electron which is coming here, it's a very high speed electron. This is almost impossible to measure the velocity of this electron. So, it is not possible to directly measure the kinetic energy of the electron, half mv square. So, somehow we have to replace with term with something which is more measurable. So, how do we do it? If you remember, as I told you, how do these electrons gain their kinetic energy? How do the electrons move very fast? It is because of the high voltage which was applied to them. The electrons were produced by the filament and they were accelerated by a high voltage, accelerating voltage v. Now, if you remember, if an electron is made to move between two plates. Let us say we have two metal plates across which there is a high voltage applied. Let us say minus and this is plus. This is, let us say, cathode and this is, let us say, anode, positive anode. And if there is an electron over here, which is going to move from cathode to anode, suppose this is an electron, and what is applied? There's a voltage V applied between the two plates, positive, negative. Voltage is V. What will happen? The electron will get accelerated towards this direction, right? Will get accelerated towards this voltage and it will gain speed. At this point, if the electron is at rest, V is equal to zero, by the time it reaches this anode here, it will have a very high velocity V. Now, what is the relation between this velocity and the applied voltage? Remember, electron gains this velocity because of the applied voltage. If this voltage was not there, the electron would have not been accelerated. It would have not gained a high speed V. So, if you remember, the kinetic energy gained by the electron is gained from the applied voltage. Now, how much is the energy gained by an electron? How much is the work done on an electron when it moves through a potential difference V? If a charge Q moves through a potential difference V, the work done on it is Q into V. So, for an electron, the work done on it is E into V because the charge of an electron is E. So, this is the energy or the work done on an electron to move through a potential difference V. And this is the energy, the potential energy of the electron, which is converted into kinetic energy half mv square. So, we can write EV is equal to half mv square. So, what this equation basically means is that the kinetic energy of the electron is gained because of the accelerating potential. So, half mv square kinetic energy is basically gained from the potential energy gained by the electron as it moves from cathode negative to anode positive through a potential difference capital V. Okay, so this is an important equation which we are using in the derivation. EV is equal to half mv square. Kinetic energy is gained from the potential energy of the electron. So, that is what we do here. So, we have this equation h nu max is equal to half mv square. Here, half mv square we replace with EV. Okay, so this equation, HC by lambda minimum is half mv square. So, half mv square we replace with EV. And that's how we get this as HC by lambda minimum is equal to EV. And then lambda minimum becomes what? So, EV comes down and lambda minimum goes other side. So, lambda minimum becomes HC upon EV. So, this is an important formula. It's an expression for the cutoff wavelength lambda minimum of continuous X-ray spectra. Okay, so lambda minimum. Now, in this equation, HC and E are constants. Only V is a variable. V is applied voltage, accelerating voltage applied to the electrons. So, H is Planck's constant, C is velocity of light, and E is the charge of the electron. If we put these three values here, then we'll get the answer as 1. If you can calculate it, if you have a calculator, put the value of H as 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34, C as 3 into 10 raised to 8, and E as 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19. With all these three values put here, you'll get the answer as 1.24 into 10 raised to power minus 7, minus 6, sorry. 1.24 into 10 raised to power minus 6 meters, which I can write it as 12400 into 10 raised to power minus 10 meters. And now, minus 10 meters is an Armstrong unit. So, the answer becomes 12400 upon V Armstrong units. So, lambda minimum can be written in a simpler form by putting the values of HC and E as lambda minimum is equal to 12400 divided by V. And the answer will, whatever answer you get here, will be directly in Armstrong unit, not in meters, because we have done the conversion. Okay. So, formula for lambda minimum is 12400 divided by V. So, if you know the accelerating voltage which is applied to the electrons, directly you can put the value of the voltage here and you can calculate the value of lambda minimum. For example, if the voltage applied is 12400 volts, if the accelerating voltage applied is itself is 12400, what will be the value of lambda minimum? It will be 12400 divided by 12400, which will be 1 Armstrong unit. So, if the accelerating voltage is 12,400 volts, then the lambda minimum of the continuous X-rays will be 1 Armstrong unit. Okay. Now, as I told you, X-rays are of two types, characteristic and continuous X-rays. And both these X-rays are produced simultaneously. It's not that only characteristic X-rays are produced or only continuous X-rays are produced. So, this is the X-ray spectra which is seen when fast-moving electrons strike the target. So, you can see these things here, this is continuous X-rays and this value here is lambda minimum. This value here is lambda minimum here. This is lambda minimum. Okay. So, this is the minimum wavelength and above this all wavelengths are there. And this what you see here, peaks are the characteristic X-rays, K alpha, K beta line and so on. Okay. So, both the spectra are superimposed on each other. Continuous, this is the continuous X-ray spectra on which the fixed lines, X-ray discrete lines, fixed lines, sharp lines K alpha K beta are superimposed on each other. So, this is the X-ray spectra which is seen when fast moving electrons strike a suitable target. Okay, so continuous X-ray spectra and sharp lines characteristic X-ray spectra superimposed on each other. Thank you.